Chargers training camp will be here until noon. P is out today. In his place, Daniel Jeremiah, longtime scout and now, I guess, front office style analyst, amongst other things, for NFL Network. And he is part of the Rams preseason coverage. If you're watching it on Channel 2 there with Marshall Falk and Andrew Siciliano. And joining us right now, DJ, on the Chevy Silverado celebrity headset, it is the fearless general manager of these Los Angeles Chargers. And boy, did he put it down. I can only imagine if what he did at John Carroll and what you did at Louisiana Monroe, if the two of you could have just crossed paths, the sweet music the two of you could have made, huh?
I'll get open for you.
Oh, there you go. And I'll overthrow you.
I won't get much after the catch.
See there? Oh, the self-deprecation. It's just too much. It's one-upsmanship. So how are things going through two games? How are you feeling about the team? They're 0-2. Have you seen some good things, and what has you excited?
Well, some good and some bad. I mean, that's part of the preseason. I guess over 20 years of watching preseason football, you got to have some perspective on where you are. Win or lose, whether you play well or play bad, it's hard to make wide sweeping conclusions or generalizations on one side of the ball. But you can look at individual players, there's no doubt about that. As far as evaluating players, we've had some players step up and play well, and some players that got little ways to go still. So what I liked last week was our work with the Saints on Thursday and Friday was tremendous. Great tempo, really competitive, learned a lot that week. We practiced very well against those guys. I wish we'd have played a little bit better in the game on Sunday, but we got some really good work of practice last week.
You think we're going to see a lot more of that with the joint practices? I mean, you can control the environment. Bucky wrote something about it the other day and said the fact you don't have to share that tape with the rest of the league is a benefit as well. But you control the environment, you protect the quarterback, and you get a lot of good work in. Is that something you think you're going to see a lot more of?
I know from us, we will. We'll certainly work with the Saints again next year. Working with Sean Payton was great. For all the reasons you just said, you can control the tempo. It was competitive and tough, but respectful at the same time. You can control the reps a little bit. You know, if you get some receivers who are down, you can pull back. So it worked great for both sides. And like you said, it's, you know, you don't have to share anything with anybody else. Now, the other team gets a really intimate knowledge of what you have, and we can find out about them. That's a little bit of an issue, but I'll take that over having 31 or 30 other teams see what you're doing in the preseason game.
You have guys in your personnel department just eyeballing the Saints when they come in, obviously.
Yeah, it was the Saints and the Rams. I mean, just watching them know that roster like they know ours. Because that's, you know, we don't get a chance to see other teams practice ever. And you get a lot from watching a player practice. Just like when you go out to scout a player, when you watch them at a college practice, you can see all the things you don't see on the tape. You know, how they respond to their coaches, what their tempo is like practice, what they look like during practice, you know, what their eyes are like. So it was very beneficial.
We know that Anthony Lynn wants to run the football. He's done that his entire career. When you look at the statistics, no one's run it better than the teams he's been part of for the last 7 or 8 years. And that's seemingly, at least statistically, been an issue for this team through two preseason games. Is that a concern for you at all?
Sure, because, you know, what we've seen on the practice field has been pretty darn good. But on game day, it just hasn't clicked yet. But we're on top of it. We still got some work to do. I think we're still going to be all right. I really do. But we got some work to do in that area these next couple weeks to try and get that a little more fine-tuned. It's going to take some time, obviously.
How much of it for Melvin is different with, I mean, because Ken Wisenhunt's still here, but again, when you have a head coach that's, you know, where he's made his bones, does it change the way he's asked to run?
Probably a little bit, but I haven't seen any issues with him running the football in the preseason. It's been more, I guess, second, third, fourth quarter where we haven't run it as well. So, no, I mean, there. We'll block some things a little bit differently with Anthony. There'll be some scheme changes, but in the end, you know, you're running power, you're running counter for the running back. It's all the same.
You got a bunch of good young players on this team. Dexter McCoyle had a big play last week with the pick six, going almost the full length of the field. Has there been a young guy maybe off the radar that you've just watched progress through this camp that has you really pumped up and excited about?
Well, I hate to answer those questions because everyone listening.
No, it's just LA. This is not.
Yeah, nobody's listening right now.
The easy answer to that is what you guys have seen in camp and then in the game on Sunday is Desmond King has done a really nice job playing some multiple positions for us, playing some nickel, playing some safety. And, you know, he has a nose for the football as far as breaking up, finishing plays, intercepting the ball. He made a tremendous play in the Seattle game. He came on a blitz off the edge. They threw the ball over the top of him into the flat. He turned and caught him, that player, from about 60 yards away, 70 yards away, and punched it out. It's just one of those plays you don't see very often. So he's coming along, which is good. We need some depth in the secondary. I think there's going to be a role for him. I'm not sure what that role is going to be, but he's making too many plays to not have a spot on this team.
DJ and I were at the combine together, and I remember sitting with Bucky Brooks, one of our colleagues there, and he had mentioned, I want to watch this Desmond King. He's like, you look at the tape, and he's always around the football. And then he kind of had a rough go at the combine. When you when you talk about a player athletically and in that environment versus a football environment, how do you separate that as an Italian evaluator?
Well, you would love all your corners to be 6 foot two and run 4.4. God doesn't make very many of those. So you have to look at some other traits. And with Desmond, you know, he's not a 4.4 guy. He runs 4.55. It's not the worst thing in the world. He's not 4.65 or 4.7. He's 4.55. But he has really good game speed, and the fact that his instincts are excellent. So he can get a jump on the ball. He's very quick in short area, which makes up for the fact that he's not top speed, but he's very quick short area. Has great hands, as you can see, to finish plays, and he'll tackle. I mean, he's a physical corner. So there's a lot of things I think we can do with him.
People probably don't know this, but, I mean, how many calls are you getting this time of year? We just saw a trade. Seattle loses a left tackle. They make a trade with the Eagles to bring in one. How many phone calls are you fielding right now? Just the early part of the process, feeling out what your roster shakeup is going to look like.
Yeah, constantly in the preseason, and really our pro department is constantly talking to other teams' pro departments and discussing where we have some surplus, where we have some need, some players that may be potentially tradable. And those calls go on all the way through preseason. It will really pick up this week and next week as we get ready to cut the 53. As teams start to really get a feel for where their cut the 53 is going to be, there'll be a lot more names out there that may be tradable or possibly a waiver claim.
I know you don't want to speak about specific players. You mentioned Desmond King, but just because of the size and the athleticism and how he fits in as a defensive end, Chris McCain, and, you know, at 6 foot five, I don't know what his actual measurements are, but he's listed as 6'5", 235, I think. But playing an end position, is that where you see him, and what have you seen from him so far in the preseason?
Chris has been interesting. Chris has had a number of opportunities in this league, different teams, different schemes. Sometimes it's right place, right time. And I think Chris is hungry for this. I mean, you only get so many opportunities. He's been in the league for, you know, at least 3 years now. I may be wrong on that, but he's been on multiple teams. You got to find the right spot. You know, he's kind of turned the corner for us a little bit. He's working hard. He's gotten better with his pass rush technique. Like you say, he's got long arms. He's quick off the ball. He plays hard. He needs to get, you know, special teams is going to be a big part of his play here too. But he's doing a really, really nice job for us. It's good to see.
One of my favorite players on your roster is the young tight end, Hunter Henry. Loved him coming out of college, and we saw last year what he was capable of. And just being out here at training camp a couple times, it seems like he's even made that next step in his career. When you were watching him and studying him coming out, was there any comparison you had for him or anybody you remind you of?
You know, the one we had talked about internally was he reminded us of a Heath Miller-type tight end because he wasn't just a pass-receiving threat. I mean, he gets on the line of scrimmage, and as a tight end at Arkansas, you have to block. If you don't block at Arkansas, you won't play. So he did have that base coming out of college, which is hard to find at tight end. So we think he can do both phases. He can block, do some dirty work at the line of scrimmage, got great feel in the passing game, really smooth athlete, can pull away from linebackers, and you know, we've seen him. He's just very mature. We saw last year at his age, at only 21, how mature he was. But he has taken the next step, and he'll get enough balls between him and Antonio this year.
Does anything surprise you with Antonio anymore? I mean, he looks like he did 5 years ago when we're watching him. It's crazy.
Yeah, his stop and start quicks really to this day is the same as when I got here, you know, 5 years ago, which is just rare, which is why he's going to go to the Hall of Fame. I mean, There's traits that guys have that are Hall of Fame type traits, and he has that. He comes in great shape, obviously, but there aren't very many people like him. And when you combine his quickness and his feel for the game, and the fact that our quarterback knows exactly where that ball needs to be for Antonio, it's just still a great combination for us.
Yeah, he still looks like he can go for another 4 or 5 years. Yeah. The way he's playing, it's ridiculous. This week, play the Rams, the whole fight for L.A. thing. It's been a slogan, but it's been something I think is real. You guys are competing with that football team for eyeballs and attention here in town. How much can we anticipate seeing the key guys this week, week three of the preseason?
Yeah, I just want to clarify one thing. I mean, this fight for L.A.,
like, I know
we're
it's
not
a PR.
Fighting
I know
with
it's
the Rams.
Yes.
We're not fighting for fans.
It's
we're
not just, what I heard. It's you and Les Snead right at the 50. Singlets, yeah. Headgear, wrestling.
That would be interesting.
Roman
I wouldn't pay
Greco.
For that, but yeah, we're fighting for our community. We want yeah. That's what we want to do. We want to fight for everybody in L.A. to show, hey,
that's
this,
not
this,
as much
this
fun.
Is what we are.
That's
I know. No, this is like a Jets and Giants game, really, yeah. for us. I mean, it's a big game. And I know it's preseason, but it's a third preseason game, so Stars will play a little bit more, certainly more than the first and second game. And we'll get a better feel for where we are. But I think it'll be a great atmosphere. Get to play in the Coliseum, which, you know, I love old historic stadiums, so that'll be fun, and play the Rams. So it'll be a fun preseason game.
It's Chargers General Manager Tom Telesco with us. As I look at the list of players I have in front of me, I've got a big OUT over Mike Williams. But at StubHub Center on Sunday, we saw him running. Running hunters and actually running at a pretty brisk pace. I mean, not sprinting, but and looked pretty good doing it. Where is he at right now?
Yeah, he feels really, really good, and he's doing more every week. He's running really well. But with his injury, we need to stay with the plan and not push forward just because, oh, he feels great. I mean, this is not a hamstring. It's not a, you know, it's not a knee injury or shoulder. This is it's a back. So we got to be careful with that. So we're still staying with the same plan. I mean, he's going to run heavy this week and next week, and hopefully progress more when we get to September 1st. But the great thing is there's been great progress, no setbacks. So we got to stay with the plan that our doctors have and Dr. Watkins have in place and keep going from there.
One of the things you haven't heard a lot about is in terms with you guys is the adjustment with the move. It seems like you guys have almost had the policy of, hey, let's just put that out of our mind and let's just get out here and take care of business. But how big of a challenge has it been from the move from San Diego here to Los Angeles?
I'll tell you what helped us a lot, Dean Spanos had decided to do this. It's really helped our football team is, you know, we stayed in San Diego for the off-season program. So for the football team, with the players and coaches, there was really no disruption. We came into work every day, got our work done. They gave everybody time to prepare to move. So, you know, you could drive up, look at some places, look at some schools for your kids, but you'd have to do it in a week. You had months to do it. And I think that made everybody a little bit more comfortable with the move. And the fact that we weren't moving that far obviously helped too. So we got all our work done until June 15th. It was business as usual. We had, you know, 4 weeks to get everybody moved up here. And then once we got here, our people at our building, as far as Jonathan Lucas and his group of people, had our building ready to go when we got back. So when the coaches came back from vacation, their offices are ready. You know, their video setup is ready to go. Our locker room is ready there. This training camp set place is all set. So players moved in and started to get to work. So it's been a great group of people. All the departments getting things ready to go. It's been really impressive to see.
Going back to that third preseason game, Tom, you heard Coach say, and I'm sure, you know, you're part of that decision, you know, starters for the full first half likely, and then maybe even a series in the third quarter as well. When you hear, oh, it's just kind of vanilla, we don't want to show anything, can you still get an evaluation? And what is it that you're evaluating? What are you looking for if it's not your standard game plan?
No, you can absolutely still get an evaluation. Sometimes it's better to put some guys in some positions that are going to challenge them. That may not be an ideal position, but it may happen during the regular season and see how he can handle it, see how individual players can handle it. You know, whether you're an offensive lineman working on blocking a defensive end, doesn't matter what the scheme is, we can still watch how that player plays. So, it'll be a little bit vanilla for us. I'm sure it'll be vanilla for the Rams as well. That goes both ways. There's no excuses as far as, well, you know, we didn't game plan, they game plan. It'll be the same for both teams, but you still get, you know, some good football evaluation of one-on-one matchups and how guys fare.
What's it like having Gus Bradley in the building?
A lot of energy, and we were the reason we were trying to hire Gus so badly is we felt we had some players already in place that fit his defense. Sometimes when you hire a new coordinator, you got to flip the personnel. It takes a year or two, sometimes 3 years, to get what he needs. We felt like we had a good crew in place that could fit what he wanted to do. He's a great teacher, a great communicator, and he can motivate. I mean, if you can do those three things, you can be a really good football coach. So he's been great to be around.
Last thing. We talked about this at the top of the show. We got the fight for L.A., and then you got the Conor McGregor-Floyd Mayweather fight on Saturday night. Have the players discussed, is this game is probably going to end right around the time that fight's going to get going? Is there any plans to help these guys out if, in fact, they want to watch? Is there anywhere that DJ and I can go?
We're being selfish.
Is there any plan for you to have that being screened somewhere in that building?
We may have to work on that. I'm embarrassed to say I am so out of touch with the outside world during training camp. I didn't even know the fight was this weekend. I don't even know anything about it, to be honest.
Well, there we go. Something else on your agenda.
But you know what? To keep you guys happy, we'll figure something out.
See, now we're talking. Get this man a donut. Yeah.
There we go. Yes. Would you like a donut? It is our door prize for all of our guests that join us. Tom, we know you're busy and you like to be out there on the field instead of sitting here with us. We appreciate the time. We'll see you out there at the Coliseum on Saturday.
Great. Thanks for having me, guys.
All right, there he is, general manager of the